Welcome to the class. I'm so sorry for the delay. I got stuck up in a real bad traffic today, so couldn't help it actually. Good evening, Abhishek. Good evening, Ganesh. Good evening, Supraja, and good evening, Amrita. Yeah, so in the last class we were discussing about capital budgeting. I hope the concept was clear to everybody. The investment decision, the present value of the future cash flows, the net present value approach, the IRR approach, the calculations. I hope to that extent we are all together. Okay. So today we would be starting with a discussion where we would be discussing all the methods together. We would try to do some practical questions. Maybe that we would not be able to do all the practical questions today, but we'll try to do as much as we can, and we will be continuing this discussion in the next class as well. See, basically I had discussed with you in the last class that we have to discount all the future cash flows to the present value in order to find out the net present value. Right? I had also discussed with you the payback period method where we did not discount the cash flows, and then we converted into a discounted payback period method where we had discounted the cash flows. Right? So, and we also did the IRR approach, and we tried to calculate the internal rate of return. Now today what we'll do, we'll try to first look at all these methods together in one question, so that the concept becomes absolutely clear to us. So the question is, the situation is given to us where cash flows have actually been given to us. So we are not required to calculate the cash flows. We are starting with this particular practical question. It says, a company has an investment opportunity costing rupees 40,000 with following expected net cash flow after taxes and before depreciation. Cost of capital is 10%. So these are net cash flows each year. Every year, this is going to be the net cash flows. Determine A, investment opportunity is for rupees 40,000. So in the year 0, you have to invest rupees 40,000. And if you do that, from year 1 to 5, you would be getting 7,000 rupees per year. In year 6, you would be getting 8,000. In year 7, you would be getting 10,000. In year 8, you would be getting 15,000, and so on and so forth. So the data has been given to us for the next 10 years. We have to find out the payback period on the basis of undiscounted cash flows, which I think would be very simple. If you just want to do a logical guesswork, where would be the payback period standing? Somewhere in between which years? In this particular case, you can just give it a try. Then payback period on the basis of discounted cash flows you have to find out. Net present value you have to find out. Profitability index you have to find out. And also determine IRR with the help of 10% and 15% discounting factors. So this is why I like this particular question, is because this contains all the methods, so it's very good for revision purposes. Such kind of questions you should keep for your revisions, because this helps you in revising all the concepts in just by doing one particular question. So the question is clear. 40,000 you invest today and you would be getting the returns which have been given to you in year 1 to 10. Now you have to first find out the undiscounted cash. You have to first find out the payback period on the basis of undiscounted cash flows, right? So that should not be difficult. Why? Because what does payback period says? It is the period which will be taken to get my money back. And how much I have invested? I have invested 40,000 rupees. So in how many years, yeah, right Ganesh, in how many years will I be getting my 40,000 back? In year 1 to 5, you're getting 7,000 each year. That means by the end of 5th year, you would be getting 35,000 rupees. And in year 6, you're getting 8,000. That means 35 plus 8 is equals to 43,000. So somewhere between 5th and the 6th year, you would be getting your payback, right? So it should be 5 plus, like 5 years, why I'm saying? Because in 5 years, you're getting 35,000 rupees. Then the remaining is 5,000. So 5 years plus 5,000 divided by 8,000 will give you the payback period in this particular situation. This is based upon what we had discussed in the previous class as well. So it is for payback, the cash inflow, it is 5.625 Ganesh. It has to be in terms of years. So if we are going to calculate in terms of 5,625 years, it would be a very long period of time. Nobody would like to invest, right? So it has to be 5.625 years. Yes, you missed the point. So the cash inflow arising from the investment should be rupees 40,000 to get the payback. In the first 5 years, you're getting 35,000 rupees. Now remaining 5,000, because only 5,000 would be left, this would be recovered in the part of year 6. And because the full year is going to pay you rupees 8,000, so 5 divided by 8,000 will tell you that in 5.625 years, if you do not discount the cash flows, you would be getting your money back, right? Is this clear to everybody? We had discussed this in the previous class as well. Now, logically again, if I am asking you that if I use discounted payback period method, if I use the discounted payback period method, will the period be more than 5.625 years or will it be less than 5.625 years? If I decide to use the discounted payback period method, will this period increase or will this period decrease? Because, you know, this is how you have to logically understand the numbers. Come on, I'm waiting for the response. If I change the method from undiscounted payback period to discounted payback period method, will this period, this payback period increase or will it decrease from 5.625? It will decrease. Why so? What about others? I'm not getting any responses from other candidates here. Because money will have future value. But the future money will have a present value, right? When we discount, when we are discounting the cash flows, what we are doing is we are discounting it to the present value. And if you discount something, like when you go to a shop and you ask for a discount, the amount is reduced, right? So if the amount will be reduced, the period will be more. So the period will increase, not decrease. Right? The period will increase. Now let us understand how much does it increase. So for the first 7 years, you're getting, for the first 5 years, yeah, payback period will increase. For the first 5 years, you're getting 7,000 each year. Okay. So rather than, counting and finding out present value for each year, we can use the present value annuity factor as I discussed with you in the last class. When you're getting the same amount for the consecutive 5 years, you can multiply it with the present value of annuity factor at the rate of 10%, which is 3.791, right? I hope you remember that, and I hope you must have practiced some parts of the questions back at home as well. So 3.791 we multiplied, so 26,537 rupees you can get in the first 5 years. In the sixth year, you're getting 8,000 rupees. Multiplying it with the present value of the present value discounting factor at the rate of 10% for 6 years, which is 0.564. So the amount becomes 4,512. So if I add it to 26,537, it is 31,049. Then we have the seventh year cash flow of rupees 10,000. Multiply it with the present value discounting factor at the rate of 10% for 7 years. It becomes 5,130. So the amount is coming as 36,179 by adding 5,130 to 31,049. We've got 36,179. In the 8th year, you're getting 15,000 rupees. Multiply these 15,000 rupees with the present value factor for 8 years at the rate of 10%, which is 0.467. So this becomes 7,005 rupees. Now when I add 36,179 to 7,005, I am getting 43,184 and my initial cash outflow was 40,000 rupees. So in this situation, my payback period should stand somewhere between 7 to 8 years. Right? So what I will write? I will write 7 plus, I've already got 36,179. So 40 minus 36,179 is equal to 3,821 divided by this 7,005. Divided by this 7,005, it gives me 7.5455 years. So in 7.5455 years, I'm not only going to get my 40,000, but I'm also going to get 10%. I'm also going to get the 10% cost of capital in this particular period. So in 5 years plus period, I was getting undiscounted payback. In 7.5455, I'm getting discounted payback. So the difference between the two, why the period has been increased? Because in this period, you're not only getting your 40,000, but you're also getting a cost of capital on that rupees 40,000 at the rate of 10%. Right? Got the point why the period has increased? Now we go to the next method, which is a net present value method. We have been told that we also have to find out the net present value at the rate of 10%, and 15% was there for IRR method, so we have done both the calculations. So if I discount it at 10%, I've already done that for when I did the discounted payback period method. So 26,537 for year 1 to 5, then 4,512 for year 6, 5,130 for year 7 and 7,005 for year 8. This I had already done. Similarly, I calculated it for year 9 and year 10 at 48,968. When I increase the discounting rate, my cost of capital increased. And as my cost of capital increased, the present value of the future cash flows reduced to 39,413. So what we want to say over here is that at the cost of capital of 10%, the project has got a positive net present value of 8,968. And because it has got a positive net present value of 8,968, the project may be taken up at a discounting rate of 10%. But if we increase the discounting rate to 15%, now this discounting rate is a symbol of your cost of capital. So if the cost of capital is 15%, then the project is unviable because it is giving you a negative net present value. Right? Are you able to understand? Are you able to interpret? See, in the examination and otherwise also, it is not only important to solve the question, but it is also equally important to interpret your solution. You should be able to explain what the conclusion is, right? So you should be able to write that when the cash flow, that the net present value is positive at the cost of 10%, but as the discounting rate increases to 15%, the net present value becomes negative and the project becomes unviable. So let us try to find out, the profitability index of this particular project. Now you would say that, ma'am, why profitability index is required? And what is this particular method? It is similar, the numbers are quite similar to the NPV method. In the profitability index method, we try to find out the present value of cash inflow, which you have already computed in the previous slide as 48,968 or 969, whatever you want to take it. And the present value of cash outflow is 40,000. So the present value of cash inflow divided by present value of cash outflow gives you a profitability index. Whenever the net present value would be positive, the profitability index would be more than 1. And whenever it would be more than 1, we can say that the project may be taken up. But why do we need this particular calculation? Because you've already done the calculation of net present value, and based on that also you've said that the project may be taken up. This particular method is most relevant when we have got two different projects with two different cash outflows and two different cash inflows, and where we want to compare between the two projects. Now supposing I just give you another data where I say that there's another project where the present value of cash outflow is 50,000 and the present value of cash inflow is 60,000. So would you accept that project, or would you like to invest? Because if you've got only 50,000 rupees, you cannot invest in both the projects. So if you have to choose between this project and that project, which project would you like to choose? So you would say that in the second project, my present value of future cash inflow is 60,000 rupees. Now let us try to solve it. And my present value of cash outflow is equals to 50,000, right? So can you calculate the profitability index? Can you calculate the profitability index? It would be 60,000 divided by 50,000. What are you getting? Now in this particular case, even though the project is giving you a higher net present value, right, the NPV, what is the NPV of this project? It is 10,000 rupees, right? The net present value is 10,000 rupees, while in the other case, the case that we were looking at, the net present value was 8,969. But still, if you look at the profitability index, the profitability index of the project that we have in hand is 1.22, and the profitability index of this particular project is 1.2. So 1.22 being higher than 1.2, we would recommend that if the two projects are mutually exclusive, that if we decide to choose the one, we cannot choose the other. In that situation, we should choose the project which has got a higher profitability index of 1.22, in spite of the fact that the net present value given by that particular project is lower than the net present value given by this particular project. So you understand why profitability index is required, because you are able to, like, this is like calculating the percentages, isn't it? Just by comparing the numbers, we would not be able to give the right conclusion. Someone has got, why not directly calculate profitability index in case of NPV? See, profitability index you would be calculating when you've got two different proportions. If you've got only one proportion, in that situation NPV is also... I hope I'm again audible because there was some disconnection at my end. See, what I was saying is that if you have got two different projects, then it is required to calculate profitability index. Otherwise, you can simply calculate the net present value, and if the net present value is positive, you can say that we can go ahead with the project. You're getting my point? It's like that, you know, supposing in one particular examination, the pass percentage is 40 marks out of 60. Now, if you've scored 40 marks out of 60, go ahead. You would be in the next class. But if someone wants to compare the percentages of 2, 3, 4, 5 different students, then you need to understand as to, you know, how everyone is doing. So, similarly, if you get a positive net present value, you can move ahead with the project. But if you have got 2, 3, 4, 5 different projects in hand, then you have to calculate the profitability index. Got it? The next is calculation of internal rate of return, which I had discussed with you in the last class as well. We had discussed this formula, IRR is equals to lower rate plus lower rate NPV divided by lower rate NPV minus higher rate NPV multiplied by difference in rates. Now, in this particular case, your lower rate is 10%, your higher rate is 15%. Your lower rate net present value is 8,969 and your higher rate, that is the net present value at 15%, is minus 587, right? And the difference in rates is of 5%. So, placing the numbers in the formula as we did in the last class as well, 10% plus 8968 divided by 8968 or 69, whatever you want to take, minus 587 multiplied by 5. So, you will first solve the fraction. Then you will multiply the fraction with 5 and then you will add it to 10 to find out 14.7%. So in this particular case, what we understand is that this particular project has got an internal rate of return as 14.7%. So any project, in any case, if you can keep your cost of capital less than 14.7%, the project would be profitable for you. But if your cost of capital would be more than 14.7%, then the project would start becoming unviable. So IRR is important because it gives you an indication, okay, that now that this particular project has got this kind of a return, so can I actually arrange funds? So you tend to understand what is the scope in which you can arrange your cost of capital, right? So that is where IRR method is also very, very important, and the NPV method is also a very important and interesting method. But there are situations when it will happen that supposing you've got two projects and one of the projects has got a higher net present value as compared to the other project. But if you look at the IRR of the two projects, maybe the project with a higher net present value has got a lower IRR. So then you would tend to get confused as to which is the project that you should accept. Are you able to follow what I'm trying to say? I'm saying, supposing NPV method suggests project A because it has got a higher NPV. Supposing you had to choose between project A and project B. So and if we go by NPV method, NPV method says go with the project which has got a higher net present value, right? And the IRR method says that go with the project which has got a higher IRR, right? And supposing the IRR of project B is more than project A. Now, in that situation, how should you choose between the two projects? How should you choose? We just discussed about the profitability index method, but that is a solution to the NPV method. But supposing IRR also presents in front of us a different picture, and in that situation, how do we solve that problem? So the question is getting clear to you? The situation is getting clear because now I believe the method should be absolutely clear to everybody. Anybody who still has got any doubts with respect to NPV, IRR, PI, payback period and undiscounted payback period methods. Any questions in these five methods, anybody? So as no questions are coming up, I'm slightly increasing the complication. Let me first tell you that there are, you know, we would be talking about two kinds of projects. One is independent and second are mutually exclusive. In case of independent projects, what do we mean to say is that supposing, you know, you've got 10 lakh rupees. Now, out of that 10 lakh rupees, supposing you want to invest some part of it in equities and some part of it in buying some assets, right? Now, the two things are mutually exclusive. The two things are independent of each other. You can take both of them together, right? So in the equity segment also, you would be finding out which would be the best investment, and in the asset segments as well, you would also be finding out which are the best alternatives. But it is not like that if you invest in equity, you would not be able to invest in assets, right? Both of them are independent. Both decisions are independent of each other. Whenever the two decisions are independent of each other, whenever the two projects are independent of each other, we suggest that Go for both the projects if they've got the positive net present value. Go for both of them till the time they've got the positive net present value. But at times we are in a fixed kind of a situation where the projects are mutually exclusive. Like if I have to buy one air conditioner, I will have to decide whether I should buy it the air conditioner from Hitachi or should I buy the air conditioner from Toshiba. Both are Japanese brands and both are equally good. So I have to, but I have to choose the one between the two. These kinds of decisions are called mutually exclusive decisions. If I decide to buy Hitachi, I cannot buy Toshiba, and if I decide to buy Toshiba, then I cannot buy Hitachi, right? But if I have to decide between, like if I have to invest my money in a refrigerator and an air conditioner, I would be choosing both if they both are giving me the positive net present value. I hope the point is clear. So in case of independent projects, the cash flows of one are unaffected by the acceptance of the other. But in case of mutually exclusive projects, the cash flows of one can be adversely impacted by the acceptance of the other. So if I accept one, I would not be accepting the another one. Let me give you the concept in a better manner. Supposing there is a company which is considering three methods of attracting customers to expand its business by undertaking. The company is deciding that it wants to attract its customers. So it wants to decide upon how they should go for advertising. So one is that they should go for advertising campaign. Okay, if they decide to go for advertising campaign, they will have to invest rupees 1 lakh. Second alternative in front of them is to display neon signboards. You must have seen the neon signboards on the roads. So if they do that, they will have to spend rupees 1,50,000. And the third alternative is that they go for direct delivery service. And if they go for this alternative, they will have to spend rupees 1,50,000. Right? So they have to choose that which particular method would be the best. It is given to us that if A is carried out but not B, if A is carried out but not B, that means A and B are mutually exclusive. In that situation, it has got an NPV of 1,25,000. So if we decide to go for advertising campaign but we do not go for display of neon signboards, the net present value would be 1,25,000. But if B is done and not A, B has got a net present value of 45,000. B has got a NPV of 45,000. By investing 1,50,000, you are getting a net present value of 45,000. And by investing 1 lakh, you are getting a net present value of 1,25,000. If I have to choose between the two, I would definitely choose which one? Which one will I choose? If I have to choose between A and B, which one will I choose? First of all, Ganesh says A, very good. So however, if both are done, if you decide to go ahead with both A and B, then the net present value is rupees 2 lakhs. If you decide to go ahead with both of them, then the NPV is rupees 2 lakhs. Okay. The NPV of the delivery system C is rupees 90,000. I'm coming to that. The net present value of delivery system C is rupees 90,000. Its NPV is not dependent on whether A or B is adopted, and the NPV of A and B does not, A or B does not depend on whether C is adopted. So C is independent of A and B. If you decide to go ahead with C, you would be getting a net present value of rupees 90,000. Now, which of the investments should be made by the company if the firm has got no budget constraint? If the budget is not limited, in that situation, which all investments should be made by the company? Anybody? If the budget is not limited, which all investments should we make? All has got positive NPV, so all should be accepted, right? All A, B and C, all of them have to be accepted because the budget is not a constraint. So we will have a positive, because all have got a positive net present value. Second is, if the budget amount is only rupees 2,50,000, if the budget amount is only rupees 2,50,000, which one will you accept? See, if you accept A and C, because in 2,50,000 you can go for A and C, you're getting a net present value of 1,25,000 plus 90,000, which is equals to 2,15,000. If you decide to invest B and C, no, that you cannot do because the budget is not there, you can invest in A and B. This will give you a net present value of rupees 2 lakhs. So it is advisable that we go for A and C rather than B and C, rather than A and B. You're getting my point? If I go for A and B, we have been told that the net present value is rupees 2 lakhs. And if we go for A only, then we have got the net present value of 125. And if I go with C, I'm explaining. See, if you go ahead with, now you have got 2,50,000 rupees. So what are the possible combinations? The possible combinations are either A and C or A and B. Right? The possible combinations are either A and B and or A and C. Right? This or this, because 2,50,000 is there with us. If I decide to go with A and B, it is given to us that if both are done, then the net present value is rupees 2 lakhs. Okay? Now, then let me compare it if I go for A and C. It says that if A is carried out but not B, then it has got a net present value of rupees 1,25,000. And if C is adopted, then the net present value is 90,000. So if I go for A and C, then my net present value is 2,15,000. I compare it with 2 lakhs, so then I'll go with whichever is higher. So I will go with A and C. Got it? So now you understand the difference between independent and mutually exclusive projects. Mutually exclusive is if one is accepted, the other will not be accepted. So in that situation, we should accept that particular project which has got a higher net present value. But if the projects are independent, like in A and B, right? But in case if the projects are independent, like in case of A and C, we should accept all the projects which have got a positive net present value. Now, I am coming to that kind of a problem which I was discussing with you, where NPV method is giving you a different result and the IRR method is giving you another result. Let us look at this question. The cash flows of two mutually exclusive projects are as under. Project P, you will have to invest 40,000 rupees. In year 1, you are getting 13,000. In year 2, you are getting 8,000. In year 3, you are getting 14,000, 12,000, 11,000 and 15,000 till year 6. If you decide to invest in project J, here the project J has got an initial investment of 20,000. T1 gives it 7,000, T2 13,000 and T3 12,000. Now, whenever you've got two different projects which have got, different time frames, where you've got two different projects which have got two different time frames, it is generally not advisable to compare them, you know, just on the basis of net present value. You have to find out the equalized annual value, which I would be discussing with you. Just let me first explain the question to you. Because in this particular question, the most specific thing is that one project is completing in 3 years, another project will be giving you inflows till year 6, right? So now you have to first estimate the net present value of project P and project J using 15% as the hurdle rate. We call this cost of capital discounting rate also as hurdle rate. So these are synonyms that you will have to understand. They can be used in place of each other. So 15% is the discounting rate for project P and project J. Estimate the IRR of the project P and project J. That also you can do. Now, we would be seeing if there is a conflict between NPV and IRR. And if yes, then how do we make a project choice? Let us first find out the net present value. We have been given the discounting rates at the rate of 15%, 18%, 20%, 24% and 26% from year 0 to year 6, which we will be using in our questions. Now we have to first find out the net present value of project P and J using 15% hurdle rate. The initial cash outflow in case of project P is 40,000 and in case of project J is 20,000. In case of project P, you would be getting the cash inflows in a 6-year period. We will be discounting those cash inflows for the 6 years period at the discounting factor of 15%. And after discounting, we have got the net present value of rupees 5,376. Right? I am not going into calculations again because we have done a lot of it. Then if we go to the net present value of project J, project J has got an initial cash outflow of 20,000 rupees and you are going to receive 7,000, 13,000 and 12,000 in the first 3 years. Discounting it by 1.15, which is 15% rate for 3 years, you are getting a net present value of 3,807.41. Now we have been given in this particular question that the projects are mutually exclusive. If you look at the question says the two projects are mutually exclusive to each other. And we have been told that by the NPV method that if the projects are mutually exclusive, we should choose that particular project which has got a higher net present value. So if I go by the NPV method, I will be choosing project P, right? Because it has got a higher net present value. Is the calculation getting clear to everybody? Right? Okay. Now let us look at the IRR of project P and project J. In case of IRR, what we have to do, we have already done the calculation at the rate of 15%. We have got a positive net present value. That means IRR has to be more than 15% or less than 15%. When we do the calculation of IRR, it would be more than 15% or it will be less than 15%. Just use your logic. We have got a positive net present value in both the cases at the rate of 15%. So IRR will be more than 15% or less than 15% because IRR is that rate at which net present value is zero. So it has to be more than 15%. Very good, Supraja. So in this particular case, we will be increasing our calculation from 15% to maybe 20%, right? And try to find out what is the net present value, and then we will be using that particular formula: lower rate plus lower rate NPV divided by lower rate NPV minus higher rate NPV multiplied by difference in rates, and find out the IRR of project P and project J. We are not going again into the calculations, but solving all the calculations, we have found that project P has got an IRR of 19.73%. And project J has got an IRR of 20.20%. Now, if I go by what has been mandated to us by the IRR method, then we should choose that particular project which has got a higher IRR. Now, here there is a catch-22 situation because project J has got a higher IRR, but project P has got a higher net present value. So, how do we solve this kind of a situation? Is the situation clear to everybody? Right? So how do we find out a solution to this kind of a problem? Profitability index may or may not work. You can supplement your decision with the help of profitability index method also. But because the catch is with IRR, so profitability index is not a very... it cannot be a very soundproof kind of a method. So wherever there is a conflict, and here the conflict is more visible because the two different projects have got two different time frames, right? So it is advisable that you find out the equal annualized criteria. In order to find out equal annualized criteria, what you should do is you should find out the number of years in which each particular project is going to give you the cash flows. The first project is going to give you cash flows in 6 years, and the second project is going to give you cash flows in 3 years. So find out the present value annuity factor. Find out the present value annuity factor at the rate of 15% for 6 years. That would be 3.7845. That would be 3.7845. Divide your net present value with 3.7845. You will find out that if you try to find out the annualized gain, if the time frame is same, then in most of the situations there would not be a conflict between NPV and IRR. Right? In most of the situations it would be the same. In case there would be any difference, it would be very, very slight difference. So in that situation you can use PI as well to supplement. But here, because the two different methods are having a different time frames, so you will have to find out that what is the annual gain coming from each of the projects. So the first project, which is project P, is giving you a gain of, on an annualized basis, because you've divided it with the present value of annuity factor for the number of years at a particular rate, and you found it as 1420.44. And if you look at project J, and divide it with the present value annuity factor for the period of 3 years at the rate of 15%, you are getting a annualized income of 1667.58. Now in this particular situation, because the annualized income of project J, the cash inflow per annum of project J is higher than project P, so it is advisable that we follow project J, right? So how do we solve in case of conflict? I hope it is clear to you now. On the similar lines, actually, we had not exactly on the similar lines, but on the similar lines, we also had a question in December 2015 examination, which I would be discussing with you. But why there was a conflict between NPV and IRR? Basically, because the basic difference between NPV and IRR is that NPV assumes that whatever returns you would be getting on a year-to-year basis, they would be reinvested at the cost of capital. And IRR assumes that the returns that you would be getting will be reinvested at the rate of return. Right? So that is where the difference comes. That is where the conflict would always be there between IRR and NPV. Because we believe in conservative approach and cost of capital would be lower than the rate of return. So therefore, in general, the assumption taken by the net present value method is considered to be more realistic. Right? Now let me explain what I'm trying to say, because this is leading to a confusion. Because if the projects would have the same time frame, still, at times you would see that the NPV method and the IRR method may give you different conclusions. Now, the reason is that in the NPV method, what you do, you divide the cash flows with 1 plus K, right? And in the IRR method, what you do, you can definitely use, but you have to understand the logic behind it, na? I am just trying to give you what is the logic why they are different. The second is IRR method. In the IRR method, you use the cash flow, the same cash flow, but you divide it with 1 plus R and not with 1 plus K. And in cases of the projects which we accept, we generally assume that R would be more than K. Right? So what happens is that when we say cash flow divided by 1 plus K raised to power 4 or 1 plus R raised to power 4. In the fourth year, what we are assuming is that whatever cash flows that you have received in the previous year, they have been reinvested at the rate of K in case of NPV and at the rate of R in case of IRR. Now, reinvestment may or may not be at the rate of R, but it would surely be at the rate of K, right? So therefore, NPV method is considered, the assumption of NPV method of reinvestment is considered to be more reliable as compared to the IRR method. Right? But wherever, because ultimately when you use the equal annualized criteria also, in that situation also you used it on the NPV method only, na? Ultimately you depended it on, ultimately you concluded your decision with the help of NPV method only. Whether, you know, you whatever further action was taken, it was taken on NPV method only. So what we want to say is that the assumptions of net present value method are considered to be more realistic, because in the last examination, that is June 2016, you've got a question, distinguish between NPV and IRR. That question was there. So the basic difference between NPV and IRR is the reinvestment rate assumption. You're getting my point? Can I get some responses, please? Okay, thank you. Okay, please explain again. See, what I'm trying to say here is, Ganesh, when we use the NPV method, what do? You write a net present value is equals to cash outflow minus cash inflow divided by 1 plus k plus cash inflow at year 2 divided by 1 plus k raised to power 2. Right? Now here, what are you assuming? You are assuming that whatever cash inflows you got in year 1, they were reinvested in the business. Right? They were reinvested in the business in the next year at your cost of capital. Okay? But in the IRR method, we are assuming that the inflows are reinvested at the rate of return. Now, when we say that the inflows would also be reinvested at the rate of return, it may be true, it may not be true. Because that is a very, very optimistic kind of an assumption. In the cases of financial management, in case of accounting, whenever we are making some estimates, we want to be conservative. We do not want to be too optimistic. So therefore, if we go by the NPV approach, it is giving us at the minimum minimum reinvestment rate. And that is why we consider it to be more reliable. You got it? So reinvestment is at a cost of capital which is lower than the rate of return, and that is why it is considered to be more reliable. It means R is higher and is also very optimistic. See, if I'm saying, okay, now let me give you a basic number, with the help of numbers I'll try to explain. What I'm trying to say over here is, ki supposing आपने एक बैंक में एफडी कराई, ठीक है? आपने 1000 रुपए की बैंक में एफडी कराई, which is at a auto renewal basis. That FD is giving you a return of, like you're getting a rate of interest at the rate of 9%. FD is on auto renewal basis, okay? Your cost of capital is 7%. Okay, is the situation getting clear? Your cost of capital is 7% means that you have borrowed this money at 7% from somewhere and kept it in the FD at the rate of 9%, and the FD is on auto renewal basis. Okay, now when we do the NPV calculation, we would discount this rate of interest at 7%. Okay. When we will be doing the IRR calculations, we would be discounting this rate of interest at 9%. Now, ab chakkar kya hai? Supposing you borrowed for a period of 5 years एंड एफडी आपने करी है अभी एक साल की ऑन एन ऑटो रिन्यूअल बेसिस, 1 ईयर एफडीआर ऑन एन ऑटो रिन्यूअल बेसिस फॉर 5 ईयर्स. बात समझ में आ रही है आपको? आपने बैंक में एक साल के लिए एफडी कर दी और ये कहा कि आप इसको 5 साल तक ऑटो रिन्यूअल करते जाइए. ऑटो रिन्यूअल करने से क्या होगा कि जब आपका एक साल एक्सपायर होगा उस समय पर अगर रेट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट 8% है तो ऑटो रिन्यूअल विल बी एट 8%. अगर रेट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट 10% पर है तो ऑटो रिन्यूअल विल बी एट 10%. अगर रेट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट विल बी एट 7% तो योर ऑटो रिन्यूअल विल बी एट 7%. इफ इट वुड बी 6% योर ऑटो रिन्यूअल विल बी एट 6%. ठीक है, इज इट फाइन? नाउ व्हाट वी आर सेइंग हियर इज कि एनपीवी मेथड में चाहे वो रेट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट 9 रुपए आए, 8 रुपए आए, 10 रुपए आए, 7 रुपए आए, 6 रुपए आए, आप सबकी डिस्काउंटिंग 1.07 से कर रहे हो, राइट? आप ये कह रहे हो कि 1.07 इज माय कॉस्ट ऑफ कैपिटल और मेरा री इन्वेस्टमेंट जो है वो हम ये मान के चल रहे हैं कि 7% पर होगा, 7% या उससे ज्यादा पर होगा. लेकिन जब आप IRR मेथड फॉलो करते हो तब आप इसकी डिस्काउंटिंग करते हो 9% पर. जरूरी नहीं है कि आपको हर साल 9% या उससे ज्यादा रिटर्न मिलेगा, पर ये जरूरी है कि आपको 7% या उससे ज्यादा रिटर्न मिलेगा. यू गेटिंग माई पॉइंट? दैट इज वाई द एनपीवी मेथड इज कंसिडर्ड टू बी द एनपीवी री इन्वेस्टमेंट अजम्पशन is considered to be more realistic. ठीक है? So as I was discussing with you that there was a question in December 2015 examination on similar lines, not on the conflict between NPV and IRR, but with two different mutually exclusive proposals with different timelines. ABC Chemicals Limited is considering two mutually exclusive proposals. Your advice is sought for choice between two options under consideration. यहाँ पर आपको cash inflows नहीं दिए गए हैं. You have been given only the costing. So you have to compare the two projects and find out that particular project which has got a lower cost. Right? Wherever the inflows are not there in front of you, you have to compare the outflows only. चलिए. So in this particular case, it says that you have got two mutually exclusive proposals. One is purchase of a petrol truck, another is purchase of a battery powered truck. Should I purchase the petrol truck or should I purchase the battery powered truck? The petrol truck has got a purchase cost of ₹1,50,000 and the battery powered truck has got a purchase cost of ₹2,50,000. And then you have been given the operating cost for 5 years. In case of petrol truck, you can have the operating cost of 24,000, 34,000, 29,000 and 31,000 in the first 4 years. And in case of a battery powered truck, you will have a 12,000 rupees per annum cost for the 5 years. Assume an investment incentive of 100% initial depreciation allowance and 30% incidence of corporate tax. What does this mean? No depreciation is allowed in subsequent years. That means that there are various, those who are studying these days ATLP course, they are much familiar with the investment incentives which I discussed with you under section 35AD, where I told you that the complete 100% depreciation is allowed as an investment allowance. 100% capital expenditure is allowed in the year in which you make the investment. So is the case in this particular case. The complete depreciation is allowed to you in the first year itself. So in the year zero, you would be getting a depreciation benefit. So the full 30% benefit would be available in the first year itself. Taxes are promptly paid. A return of 10% after tax as investment incentives is required. So your cost of capital is 10%. You are required to find out equivalent cost of the two options. So the equivalent annualized criteria wali jo baat hai, that becomes applicable over here. You have been given now two different situations. The situation is clear to everybody? You can click a picture of the question because I would like to move to the solution. Okay. Now the initial investment is 1,50,000 and 2,50,000, but because there is a 100% depreciation benefit in the first year itself, so 30% of 100% would be the tax benefit. Is the point clear to everybody, or should I explain it? The amount was 1,50,000 and 2,50,000. Okay. So if the amount is 1,50,000, in that situation, you would be able to claim a deduction of rupees 1,50,000 from your income. So that means that your tax liability will get reduced by 1,50,000 rupees. The rate of tax is 30%. So when the rate of tax is 30%, you would be able to get a benefit of minus 1,50,000 multiplied by 0.3 is equals to 45,000 rupees. So this would be the benefit, this would be the amount of tax that you would be able to save by investing in this particular machinery. Are you able to follow what I'm trying to say? No? Yes? Anybody? Okay. Next is if this amount would have been 2,50,000 rupees, in that, and the tax liability is at the rate of 30%, so you would be able to save 75,000 rupees, which is 30% of 2,50,000. Right? So the net cost of the truck is rupees 1,05,000 in case of the first option, and 1,75,000 in the second option. Right? So we have taken here 1,05,000 and 1,75,000. Now we have also been given some operating costs. Operating costs we have been given as 16,800, 23,800, 20,300 and 21,700 in case of petrol truck, and 12,000 in all the three situations. No, the amounts were more. Operating costs were 24,000, 34,000, 29,000 and 31,000, and 12,000 in each of the 5 years in case of battery operated truck. Now this operating cost also is a tax deductible expense. This operating cost is also a tax deductible expense because it is a part of cost, right? So 24,000 multiplied by 1 minus 0.3 will be the cost after tax, right? Right? Similarly here, 12,000 multiplied by 70% would be the cost after tax. So we found out the after-tax cost as 24,000 multiplied by 70% is equals to 16,800, and so on and so forth. We calculated for all the four years, and in this case where we talk about the battery operated truck, here 12,000 was the cost and 70% of 12,000 is 8,400. Now this amounts are clear to everybody. Once we have the after-tax cost, we multiply it with the present value factor to find out the present value of the cost in both the situations. So in the first situation, in the petrol truck case, the total cost including the initial cost and the operating cost is 1,69,996. And in case of battery powered truck, the total cost, which includes the initial cost and the operating cost, is 2,06,835. We have to find out the equalized cost, right? So for that, we have to find out the present value annuity factor at the rate of 10% for 4 years in the first situation, because the costing is ending at 4 years, and for 5 years in the second situation. So for 4 years, the figure is 3.17, and for 5 years, the figure is 3.79. We will divide 1,69,996 with 3.17, and we will divide 2,06,835 with 3.79 to find out the equalized cost of 53,626 in the first case and 54,574 in the second case. So in the second case, as the cost is higher, we would be choosing that particular option where the cost is lower. Because here we have to compare only the costs. The benefits are not in front of us. So in whichever case the cost is lower, the truck is cheaper, we would be accepting that particular option. So because the petrol truck is cheaper, we would be going for that particular option. Is the solution clear to everybody? It includes actually the taxation also, so it is slightly complicated, but otherwise from the methods of financial management, I think it should not be a difficult question. But when we add taxation to it, it becomes calculation once again. Okay. Okay. Let me explain. Not a problem. See, I told you, now let me take a hypothetical figure over here, then it will become easier. Assuming whether you use the petrol truck or you use the battery operated truck, assuming, because it does not make a difference, whichever truck you use, you would be able to load whatever you have been able to produce. Assuming the gross revenue of the company is rupees 3 lakhs. Okay, assuming the gross revenue of the company is rupees 3 lakhs, if we do not buy any truck and if we do not incur any operating cost, then the company would be required to pay tax at the rate of 30%. That would be equal to 90,000 rupees. So the net income of the company would be rupees 2,70,000. Is this clear? But this is something which is very hypothetical situation. So company will have to pay taxes. Okay, will have to incur some expense, whether it goes for battery truck or it goes for a petrol truck, right? So what we decide, let us assume that the company goes with a petrol truck. If we go by the petrol truck, the gross revenue does not change. The gross revenue would remain the same, but another expense will increase. What expense will increase? The company will be able to claim depreciation at the rate of 100% on rupees 1,50,000, right? So depreciation on rupees 1,50,000 will make the income of the company, you know, to be 1,50,000. And the company will also be incurring operating costs in year 1 of rupees how much? 24,000, I believe. 24,000, right. And then it will have a depreciation and it will have an operating cost. So now what is the net profit before tax? It is 1,50,000 minus 24 is equals to 1,26,000. Right? Now the company will pay tax at the rate of 30% on 1,26,000, which would be how much? How much? Give me the figure. 37,800. Now, just because the company has, we do not have the figure of gross revenue with us in the question. Just because the company has incurred this expenditure on petrol truck, company has been able to reduce its tax liability from 90,000 to 37,800. And to be very, very specific, it has been able to save this tax of rupees 45,000 on because of depreciation, and rupees 24,000 multiplied by 7,200 because of operating cost, right? And that is why it has been able to save a tax of ₹52,200. You're getting my point? Here you can see that there's a difference of 52,200. Now this 52,200 has been saved because of depreciation and because of operating cost. True? So that is what we did. When we did the calculations for operating cost and depreciation, we reduced this tax benefit of 45,000 and 7,200. You're getting my point? Because by incurring this expenditure, we would be able to save this much of tax. So this is actual cash benefit that we are getting. This is the cash benefit that we are getting by making this expenditure. Because otherwise we would have to pay this much of tax in cash. Fine? So as we have done in case of petrol truck, we can do it in case of the battery operated truck. We can do it for all years for operating cost for the petrol truck, right? Simply what you have to do is you have to multiply this amount with the rate of tax to find out the tax benefit. Yeah, so we multiplied the expenditure with 70%, right? We can do it like we can write the full amount of expenditure. Then we can reduce 45,000 from it and then we can get the net expenditure. We simply multiplied it with 70%, right? Rather than reducing 30%, from 150,000, we simply multiplied, 150,000 with 70%. That's how we did. Got it? Great. So then you know how to find out the annualized equivalent cost. That is what we did. And we found out that the annualized equivalent cost of petrol truck is cheaper than the battery operated truck. Anybody else who still needs any further clarification? Ma'am, in present value calculation, we have taken 3 digit for rupees 1, but it's 4 digit. That is fine. That does not make any difference. You can go for 3 digits calculation, you can go for 4 digits calculation, you can even go for 2 digits, which if you've got a limited time in examination and you do not want to leave a question, you can even go for a 2 digit calculation because it does not lead to much of a difference. Okay, yeah, you can go for either. We do not want that kind of a precision. When we talk about financial decisions, when we talk about decisions in financial management, we are okay with some amount of, because we're not talking about accounting over here. We're talking about financial management. So we are okay with some kind of grossing up. Basically, the idea is to have a, Even if you take it to 4 decimal places, the figure would be around 100 rupees here and there, which otherwise also can be there because we are just talking about the future cash flows. So 100 rupees here and there is not something which is very significant over here, right? So that is why here we are quite flexible with the decimal places. Fine. So I think we will close here for today. And we would be continuing with now in the next class. Basically, I want to now emphasize upon estimation of cash flows. So far, we are assuming that the cash flows have been given to us, right? We are saying that this would be the amount of cash flow. Now, I want you to estimate the cash flows and then do the discounting. Fine. So we would be doing such kinds of questions in the next class, where we would be looking at more practical aspects of capital budgeting. So I think we can close for today. time for exam preparatory. Yes. On Saturdays, I was planning it to remain the same time, around 8:15 to 9:15. Will it be fine to everybody? That's perfect. Oh my God. So then we take it on Saturdays, 8:15 to 9:15 would be exam preparatory for FTFM. And Sunday's timings, we would be discussing an ATLP class. Okay? So with this, we close the discussion for today. Good night to all of you. Thank you. Can you give an idea as to how to write? That is what we are going to do in the exam preparatory. Right? In the first exam preparatory, just write the way you write in the examination. Yes, of course you need a scanner. And you should definitely buy one. It is important that you should have a scanner with you so that you know as to which chapters are very important and what kind of questions are repeated. Achha, not that, the machine scanner. No, you do not need it, because these days in the smartphones you've got an app called Cam Scanner. Right? You can use that Cam Scanner. And then you can send me your answers by making a PDF file. So you can just download that app. For FTFM, only chapter number 1, Nature and Scope of Financial Management. Nothing beyond that. You want me to ask questions on NPV and IRR methods? Till the point we've discussed today, we can do that as well. If you want this part also to be included in exam preparatory, I'm not getting any responses. It's up to me. Okay, let me think about it, and I'll be sending you the schedule tomorrow with timetables and everything. Right? So right now I'm closing the discussion. We would be meeting again on Thursday, where we would be discussing further about exam preparatory.